The food, the fellowship, the fun, it was all great. If you missed it, well, you just missed the treat. But we're glad for those of you that came. We had a good number, and we enjoyed our time together last night. Also, let me take just a moment. I'm going to brag on Brother Johnny a little bit. Johnny, you did an excellent job Wednesday night. Thank you. Thank you for preaching God's word. Amen. And God anointed you. God used you, and we appreciate you staying. Continue to pray for Johnny. Lord will continue to use him in the days and the weeks and the months to come. You know, Brother Johnny, I'm just going to say this for whatever it's worth. How old are you now? You got to think about that. How much?
I'll be 66 next week.
I thought he said 16 for a minute. 66.
I'll be 16.
Okay. You'll be 66 next week and just entered into the call of ministry that the Lord had put on your life. Let me say unto you, first of all, it takes courage and boldness and the faith to follow God's call in your life, but it takes even greater courage and boldness when you do it at that age. I've run into people down through the years that have, one of their excuses is, I'm too old. And you know, I look back and I think about that for a minute and I wonder, maybe it's just me, but I wonder how many of our churches are missing the blessings of God because some said, I'm too old. If you look back through the Word of God, you will find that God used many a man when they were 80. You see, the Bible says that He takes the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. God's not looking so much on age. God is looking on your willingness to serve Him. Thank you for being willing to serve God. And we're praying for you. Also, a few other things for next week. Don't forget the time changes. Next Saturday night, time changes. Spring backwards. No, spring ahead. Spring ahead. Spring ahead an hour, okay? Get yourself an hour early. If you do not, guess what will happen? When you come for preaching, you'll be here in time for Sunday school. That'll be all right too, right? But remember that. Spring ahead. Next Saturday night, sometimes whenever you want to set your clock. My grandfather Wilson, when he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's, you know, I can look back on things in sorrow, but I can also look back on some funnies. That's called memories, precious memories. But I'll never forget, before he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's, when it was time to change the clock, whether it be in the fall or the spring, man, he'd start doing it Saturday afternoon by 3 o'clock. Okay, we got a witness. She still does. Okay. Well, you won't be late next Sunday. But anyhow, he would start about 2 or 3 o'clock on Saturday afternoon. He's going to change them clocks, whether it was back or forward. After he got Alzheimer's, he decided in his mind, I ain't changing time no more. He did. When it sprung ahead, if it's 9 o'clock, he's still 8 o'clock. And that's the way he stayed. You know, it's funny how we are, but I just remembered that. I want to share that with you. But don't forget, spring ahead next Saturday night, sometime, or Sunday morning, or whenever you want to do it, but spring ahead. Also, next Sunday, we're going to be having a Gideon speaker here. Brother Bill Wall will be here in our 11 o'clock worship time. We're going to have our service as normal, but during the time of preaching, he's going to come up. He's going to give a presentation of what the Gideons do. I've asked him to go ahead and sing a little for us. He can sing. And whatever the Lord's got in store. You know, I'm one of these preachers. I hate for a church to call a Gideon speaker and say, you got 5 minutes. I think they deserve the entire time. I don't get a Gideon every year. I do it as the Lord leads. But I believe it's time we have a Gideon speaker here. They do a wonderful work in getting the word of God out there all over the world. So we will be taking a love offering up next Sunday in addition to our regular tithes and offerings. So you pray about that. Prepare for that. Be ready next Sunday. We'll give a love offering to help the Gideon's International out next Sunday. So you remember that service if you would. Also, there's a revival beginning tonight at Westview Baptist Church up in Cana. I believe it begins tonight, if my memory's right. And there'll be a different preacher there each and every night preaching. Lord willing, I'll be there this Saturday night at 7 o'clock trying to deliver the message. So I desire your prayers in behalf of that revival. Man, we had a good time up there last spring. I remember that. God broke out, moved through, and I trust they're still seeing evidences of revival in that community. I believe that they are. I believe those folks up there are sincere. I believe they're hungry. I believe they're searching for God. And when you do that, he'll be found.
Amen.
But remember them in this revival that they're going through. 7 o'clock each night. Also, Sister Samantha has asked. She's helping with the decorations for Vacation Bible School. She needs empty half-gallon and gallon milk jugs. So if you could be so kind, that's what you need, right? Save those milk jugs. Clean them out good. Bring them to her. They're going to use her for Vacation Bible School decorations. So remember that. Also, our Tuesday morning Bible study each Tuesday at 10 o'clock. Don't forget that. This Wednesday night, choir practice at 6:30. Our Bible study at 7. We'll begin chapter 4 in the book of Daniel on an insane man's dream. So you come be a part of that. Also on Wednesday, March the 15th, that's not this Wednesday, but a week from Wednesday, our Wednesday night service is moved down to Holly Springs Baptist Church. Our choir will be singing. So you choir folks, mark your calendar. We need all hands on deck. If you don't sing in choir and you want to start, it's a good place to start. So come on, be a part of that. That'll be Wednesday night, March the 15th. That service is at 7 o'clock. And then on March the 19th at 6:30, our group from the Church Victory Song will be singing at Pine Ridge Baptist Church. That service time starts at 6:30, and I understand that's just the singing service. They asked them to sing about an hour and a half, so they're going to get some singing in on March 19th. At Pine Ridge Baptist Church. Also, Victory Song will be singing at Holly Springs as well. They did ask that Victory Song and the choir both sing. So remember those announcements. And Vacation Bible School, June 19th through the 23rd, we still need teachers. If you feel led of the Lord to help us out, please sign the sheet up out there and we'd be glad to have you. Any more announcements we need to make? If not, our prayer time. Certainly those that we mentioned this morning at our 9:30 time. Some of our more immediate ones is the lost. Remember them in your prayers. J.D. and Marla. J.D. gave us a report this morning that Marla's back is probably worse than they thought. That there's a vertebrae they may not be able to do anything with. Another one is going to have to heal, and it may be 3 months before it begins to heal. So she's really hurting, and I'm sure discouraged. So you continue to lift her up in prayer and also remember Brother J.D. as you pray. Also, Brother Paul Cruz, he's over to Mount Airy Hospital in room 243. I wouldn't recommend that you try to go visit him right now. The doctors think he's very highly contagious with the flu, running a high temperature. They can't get this temperature under control too good. I was by there a little bit to see him yesterday afternoon. And Paul's ready to go. If the Lord calls, he's ready. I think Phyllis was telling me that they may be talking to him about hospice first of the week. I don't know what the details will be there. But Paul needs our prayers. So you remember Paul. Continue as you pray. He's at the young age of 101. Isn't that something? God's been good to him. Also, let's continue to remember Charles and Doris in our prayers. They're still dealing with this crud stuff. Can't stop coughing. Charles is having to take those breathing treatments to help him His heart rate's real low. There's some sickness there, and they need a touch from above. So continue to lift up Charles and Doris as you pray. I mean, it just doesn't seem normal to have a worship service without Paul and Charles and Doris here. It just doesn't seem right. But, you know, let me say this too. There's coming a day we all going to check out of this world. There's going to come a day we ain't going to be here. But I got news for you. The church will still go on. The church is still strong because it's grounded on the rock. And the rock is Jesus. If the church isn't grounded on the rock, if the church is grounded on anyone other than Jesus Christ, it cannot stand. It's on sinking sand. But when the church is on the rock, it flourishes. It continues to do what God calls it to do. But we miss these folks. And we miss you. When you're not here, you're missed. I want you to know that. Because see, whether you realize it or not, we don't have assigned seats. We don't have names on the end of the pews where you sit. But see, you give it away because you sit in about the same place every week. So when you ain't here, I know you're not here. You don't get lost in the crowd. I know you're not here, and we miss you when you're not here. But let's pray for Charles and Doris. Sister Evie, continue to lift her up in prayers. Her and Jimmy both had the flu. I'm glad they're doing better with that. But continue to remember Evie with these shingles. Also, Kaylee Moore, that's Mike and Tammy's granddaughter. She's finished with her chemo treatments, but she's getting ready to start radiation. So continue to lift her up as you pray. Also, Jim and Adeline's daughter, Tina. Let's continue to remember her dealing with leukemia. Crystal Throckmorton has got some surgery coming up this week. Thomas, he fell off the ladder this week. Have I not read that portion in the scripture where Jesus says, "Lo, I'm with you always"? He didn't say hi, but anyway. He fell off the ladder, broke his arm, bruised himself up. So remember Thomas as you pray. Brother Harold's brother, Tony, continue to remember him dealing with this tumor in his brain. And then Sister Judy Sheets, sister and mother-in-law, Judy reported Tuesday they're doing much better, so we're thankful for that, but continue to lift them up. Also, I have a card here. It says, "Thank you." It says, "You are truly appreciated. Thanks again. Thanks so much for the cards and prayers. I really appreciate it." And it's signed, Bertha. We're glad Bertha's able to be back with us this morning. We've been missing her. She had to have some gallbladder surgery, but we're glad that's over and glad that she feels like being here this morning. Are there others you want to mention before we pray?
Remember Donna, he's down.
Jeff, you told me that this morning, and I feel Donna Hawks is down with her back. She's in the bed with her back, so you remember her as you pray. So you told me, and I didn't write it down. But remember Donna. Others? Yes. Remember these as you pray. God knows. Yes.
I've got a lot of lost people in my family. I'd like you to all pray for them.
Amen.
God knows who they are.
Amen. He sure does. And they know who they are. God knows and they know. But there's a cure for that sickness, thanks be unto God. Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son. He's the cure for lostness.
Joey, I have another question.
God knows. Tanner, would you pray for us this morning, please, brother?
Service from District Joy, the way that we help us, God.
Amen. Thank you for the prayer, Brother Tanner. If you're able, please stand and turn in your red hymnal to page 333. 333. Nathan, please ask the blessings on God's tithes and offerings, please. Man, you may be seated. Thank you. the organ, dear. Trying to do what God says do.
Amen.
God just laid it upon my heart while they were playing this during the offering to sing it. Maybe it goes partially with the message this morning. I don't know, but I believe in trying to be obedient unto God and trying to do what He says do. There is a river, and I'm glad there is. A river that never runs dry. Not only is it a river, it's a well. Jesus told the lady of Samaria at the well in Samaria, Sychar, John chapter number 4. Jesus was wearied in his journey, but he told the disciples, he said, I must needs go through Samaria. Jews didn't go through Samaria. I'm glad Jesus chose to go through Samaria.
Amen.
Not only did he give that woman at the well living water, you say, how do you know she got it, preacher? Because the Bible said she left her pot and went into the town to tell them what good things the Lord had done for her. And by her testimony, many were born into the kingdom of God. But not only that, they wanted to hear from this man himself. And he went into the city and told them the good news. The gospel came to Samaria through Jesus Christ. And that well of living water, guess what? Still springing today.
Amen.
It ain't went dry. You listen to this as we sing it. You just worship God this morning.
You'll never thirst again. hands in the air, get ready. Say, I thank God for saving me and what he has meant to me. Where he has brought me from and where he is leading me is unbelievable. I appreciate all you guys supporting me. I appreciate your prayers. Believe me, I need your prayers. And you know, this morning in our Sunday school class, I went around the class, and I had, for the young, those of y'all don't know, I had a senior adult. And I went around the class, and I asked each one of them, because it was part of today's lesson, who is Jesus Christ? I wish every lost person in this world could have been tuned in to that class this morning. If you want a blessing, ask some senior adult that has lived for many years, has seen many things, has been through many trials and tribulations, and has been saved for that long. If you want a blessing, ask them who is Jesus Christ. It was beautiful. It really was. That was a great class. Not anything to me. I say that. It was just such a blessing. And I like I say, I thank every one of y'all for your confidence in me because y'all come out recently. You were forewarned I was going to be here, but you showed up anyway. So I appreciate that. And I appreciate your prayer. Thank God for every one of y'all.
I was drifting away on life's pitiless sea, and the angry waves threatened my ruin to be. When away at my side, there I dimly descried a stately old vessel, and loudly I cried, ship ahoy, ship ahoy, and loudly I cried, ship ahoy. 'Twas the old ship of Zion, the sailing along, all aboard her seemed joyous. I heard their sweet song, and the captain's kind ear, ready to hear my... I messed it up. All right, we'll go again. And the captain's kind ear, ever ready to hear, called my wail of distress as I cried out in fear. Ship ahoy! Away in the blood of my Savior, and now I can say, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. From my soul I can say, bless the Lord. Oh, soul sinking down these sins' merciless waves, the strong arm of our captain is mighty to save. And trust him today, no longer delay. Board the old ship of Zion and shout on your way. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout and sing on your way. darkness. And I traded my life for a worldly good time. No peace in my heart I ever could find. And I got so tired of eating after the swine. So I think I'll go home.
He said, I will rise and I will go to my father. And he said, I will say unto my father. See, he already rehearsed what he was going to say when he got there. He said, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against thee. Make me as one of thy hired servants. Aren't you glad, though, the father saw the son coming? And before the son could say anything, the father ran and met him, fell on his neck, he embraced him, he kissed him. He said, put a ring on his finger. Said, bring me the best robe. And he said, come to the house. We've got a fatted calf ready. You see, he never made him a servant. He said, you're still my son. That's a beautiful thing right there. 2 Peter this morning for just a few minutes. 2 Peter, still there. God's left us there. I don't know where we're going to go, but God's left us there. 2 Peter chapter number 1, verse number 16. If I were titling this message this morning, it would simply be this: living in the light or stumbling in the dark. Living in the light or stumbling in the dark. Verse 16 of 2 Peter chapter 1, the Bible says, for we have not, boy, that not is very important. It explains that we have not followed cunningly devised fables. You know, if not wasn't there, it would say that we had followed cunningly devised fables. But Peter says, we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the Holy Mount.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well, that ye take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first. Hey, this is the first thing you gotta know. That no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. Now, I'm afraid many's heard that wrong all through the years, and by God's help, if I get there this morning, I'm going to try to clarify it for you. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God. Right there's key. Not just any men. Holy men. Holy means set apart, sanctified for service. But holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. They didn't speak until the Holy Ghost moved them. May God bless this precious, this portion of His precious and His holy word. Now, if we go back to verse number 16, Peter's letting everybody know that he and those other disciples, the apostles, if you will, at this time, says, we have not followed these cunningly devised fables. That word cunningly means sly and crafty. It's a clever skill. Devised means that it's planned out. And fables is a story. It's false. It's a fictitious story. Many times it's about an animal to try to deliver moral standards unto people. I'm glad to report unto you that even back in Peter's day, just as it is here in 2017, that you and I, as the children of God, we have not followed cunningly devised fables. Honey, I don't care what Reader's Digest says. Hey, honey, listen to me. I don't care what Beth Moore's got to say, and I'm not against Beth Moore. I believe she's a Christian. I believe she writes some good things. But there's a lot of Christians today that'll read more of Beth Moore's books than they'll read of God's book. Honey, right here's the right way. This is not a cunningly. It's not a skilled out. It's not planned. It's not fictitious. This word is truth, and it's alive, and it's been out for over 2,000 years right at it. And here I'm here to tell you, God gave us all 66 books of the Word of God. There's none else to be added unto it. This is what God meant for us to have. And honey, it stood the test. It'll still stand the test. And I don't know about you, but I'm going to stand on the Word of God. We need to be living in the light, not stumbling in the darkness. And the devil, he's a slickster. He's a trickster. He's got people out there in every kind of thing, every kind of book, every kind of program, every kind of class, every kind of this. There's a lot of places they'll have Bible study. Honey, they don't even open the Bible. How can you have a Bible study if you don't open the Word of God? But yet the devil has got people convinced by cunningly devised fables. He says, just like he said unto Eve, ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that the hour that you partake of this fruit, ye shall become as gods. And she fell for it. And so did Adam. And churches as a whole today are falling. Why? Because they're not in the light. They're not grounded on God's precious and His holy word. Honey, you can read all the fancy stories you want to. I remember when my young'uns was little, they had a show on TV about Barney the dinosaur. Everybody know Barney the purple dinosaur and Baby Bop and all that other crap? The morals in the story were always good. Be kind, do good, love. Huh? And all that sounds good. But you know what? You can live as morally as you want to live. You can do good to everybody. You can love everybody. You can go get your neighbor's grocery. Just like the movie last night, you can go help that homeless person and buy them food and try to get clothes on them and try to drive them around wherever they need to go. You can do all those things. But if you die lost, you'll split hell wide open. Because the Bible says, and it's not a cunningly devised fable, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Just like he told Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a good old religious fella. He thought he knew something about the word, but yet he'd never been born again. And Nicodemus came unto Jesus and talked to him at night. He didn't want nobody to see him. He didn't want the religious crowd upset at him, Marty. But Jesus cut to the chase and he said, you must be born again or you'll not see the kingdom of God. And that's the way it is today. And Jesus is the light. And Bible says that men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. It's still the same in 2017. People still love darkness because that suits their lifestyle. That suits the way they're living. They don't want to get to the light because if they get to the light, it might cause for change. But honey, if you get to the light, everything will get bright. And everything will get right. But people love darkness rather than light. And the Bible says this. Verse 17, for he received from God the Father. Jesus received from God the Father. Glory and honor. When there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son whom I'm well pleased. Verse 18, this voice which came from heaven we heard. Now not only is Peter saying we've seen it, we've been eyewitnesses to it. He said now we've heard it too. And he's talking about, if you want to go over there, you can go to Matthew chapter 17. It's at the transfiguration. That's what it's talking about. When Jesus is there on the mount with just a few disciples. I'm going to slow down because I don't want to wear out. I don't want you to get it. Jesus was there and here come Elijah and Moses. The disciples saw him. You remember the story. They said, Lord, it's good we be here. Let's build three tabernacles. What did God say? God said, this is my beloved Son. Hear ye him. And the other two left. But at that time, Elijah and Moses represents the law and the prophets. And I believe they were telling Jesus there on the mount, this is what's ahead. You already know Calvary's awaiting you. Because see, Jesus was God. He knew it, Marty. He knew Calvary was right in front of him. But yet he needed to be encouraged because not only was God, he was man. And man's weak. We're weak. Our fleshly man is weak. But Elijah was saying, hey, the law cannot save man. That's what Moses was saying, excuse me. Moses was saying, Jesus, the law cannot save man. Man cannot keep the law. And Elijah's saying, yeah, but the prophets have already predicted that you would come. I don't know exactly for sure. Let me, I'm out of time, but that's all right. I don't know exactly how many it was. I think it was 300 and some prophecies in the Old Testament that predicted that Jesus Christ would come and be born of a virgin. And honey, thanks be unto God, every one of them prophecies came to pass because that's how he was born. It would be like taking all these archers, the best archers in the world, or beginners, if you will, that can't even shoot a stick. Archery, bow and arrow. It'd be like taking somebody that ain't never picked one up in their life. It'd be like blindfolding them, spinning them around and around and around and around and around and around. You know how dizzy you get when you do that? And then turn around and say, shoot! And every one of them hit the bullseye perfect. That's the way it would be. It's miraculous!
Yeah, amen.
And Elijah was telling Jesus, the prophecies have been prophesied about you, about your birth, not only that, but your death, that you would arise. Go forward! Now, if you think disciples are good, if you read on down through chapter 17 of Matthew, you will find that after Jesus and these came down from the mount, the other disciples had been out trying to do some healing. And the Bible says a man come up to Jesus and said, my son, he's possessed of a lunatic. Said he falls in the fire and he falls in the water. And your disciples can't do nothing with him. Hey, if you don't think Jesus is the light, if you don't think Jesus is the correct way, let me say it to you. Church, being a church member, ain't gonna get you to heaven. You can join this church. You can join every church in the United States of America, and that will not get you into heaven. Be being a disciple did not guarantee them that they could heal of sickness, could it? But Jesus, God had already said, here is my beloved son, hear what he's got to say. And he came down, he said, oh foolish generation, how long have I got to be with you? What did he do? He healed that lunatic and put him in his right mind. And then the disciples come up to him privately and said, Lord, why couldn't we do these things? And then we wonder why we don't have power as Christians today. Now listen, Jesus said these things come about by much prayer. And fasting. Now I'm not going to ask you about your fasting. That's between you and God. But I'll say something to you about fasting. It ain't just giving up your meal all day. There's different ways you fast. Don't raise your hand, but I just wonder if any of you ever fasted once. You ain't in the light. You're stumbling in the dark. It comes about by much prayer. We'll pray for one person one time, Tony, and that's it. The Bible says it comes about by much prayer and much fasting. If we want power with God today, we got to do the same thing. We got to spend much time in prayer and much time in fasting. You say, we don't hear that preach no more. Well, no, you ain't going to hear it preach no more. As people try to say, well, that's old. You don't have to do that no more, honey. God's word's still true. I don't care what Reader's Digest says. I don't care what the modern books say. I don't care what commentaries say. What thus saith the word of God's still true today. Let me move on. Verse 19 says, we have also a most sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star rise in your hearts. We have a more sure word. The entire word of God is light.
Amen.
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 It's the whole counsel. Listen, there's people today that says we don't need the Old Testament, we just need the New. No, you need the whole Bible.
Amen.
All 66 books, it is the word of God. Still alive, still living, still true.
Amen.
What we need taught in schools today, amen, it's not evolution. We need to be taught there is a creating God. And mankind has been created in the image of God. That is truth. That is powerful. It separates. The world don't want to hear it. The administrators don't want to hear it. The people in charge of the school systems don't want it. The government don't want it. Why? Because their eyes are dimmed and they're stumbling in the darkness because they've never been to the light. If they come to the light, they'd know that the thing to teach is the word of God. God's word ought to be taught in the school system. There ought to be God-called men. Hey, man, I'm going to tell it like it is. There ought to be some God-called preachers in every school, every day, teaching the principles of God's holy word. And then you might not be getting the school shut up. You might not have your young'uns in the penitentiary. The jails might start to empty out because they might come to the light. But our world said, let's just stumble on in darkness. Let's just teach them what so-and-so says. Darwin and his junk. Hey, Darwin can't prove his. I prove mine.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And I don't need another book to go to, Don, to prove it. I prove her from the pages right here. And in the Bible, there's a lot of people today that try to base verse 20. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is it of any private interpretation. I want to spend a little time right there. I know I'm over, but that's all right.
Amen.
There's too many people today that want to take a verse of Scripture and cherry pick.
Absolutely. Yeah. Amen.
Go ahead.
And base their doctrine.
Go ahead, Pastor.
On one verse of Scripture.
Right.
Can I say to you, as a young man, I was guilty of that. I'll say this to you this morning too, and to everybody out there listening, I'm not ashamed of it. Some of my beliefs have changed as I have grown deeper
Amen.
In God's whole word. I used to cherry pick a verse or two, Brent said, to hell you'll go if you don't believe it my way. I have learned that God backs up his word in more than one place. Matter of fact, he'll back it up multiple places through the word of God. But you got to get in there and dig, and you got to mine, because no prophecy of scripture is of private interpretation. It's the whole word of God. It's open. If you'll read it, if you'll study it, if you'll apply it, you'll find out God's word says what it says and means what it means. And you might as well quit cherry picking a verse here and yonder and basing your doctrine on it and your holy religion and you better than thou attitude and get into the book. The whole book. I had to learn that. Now there's some things I'm going to tell you. Jesus Christ was born of a virgin.
Right.
He was sinless.
Yeah, right.
He went about doing good everywhere he went.
Amen.
He died as an innocent person for the guilty.
Right.
They buried him, and in 3 days he rose up.
Amen.
He was seen alive on the earth for about 40 days. And then the Bible says he ascended back to the right hand of the throne of God. And those are doctrines we cannot change. We cannot compromise. That's it. But there's other things you need to be sure of. Amen. Hey, there's some things I was taught in church that I have found. And I don't claim to be an expert on this Bible. But I'll tell you this much. I'll put a challenge out to you. There ain't many times you'll catch me with my britches down. What I mean by that is this. Ernie asked me last night, he said, I've been reading and studying in Psalms 34. Ain't that a wonderful chapter? I stood there just a minute. I thought, what's in Psalms 34? But there ain't many times you come at me with a book and a chapter, I can't tell you a little bit about it. Why? It's not because of me. It's because I have applied myself to God's word. And I have tried to make my calling and my election sure. You remember that last week? He called me to preach. I've got nothing to preach but this book. It's all I got to preach. And you know what I've learned? If I was to live to be 100, Sister Brenda, and God gives me health and strength, I won't never run out of nothing either. I found that out. When a preacher says I'm out of anything to preach, I say they run out of time of study and prayer. I'll tell you that. Verse 21. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Hey, friends, this book is sort of like Jesus. You say, what do you mean, preacher? It is Jesus. I know it is. John chapter 1 says that. In the beginning was the Word, the Word was with God, the Word was God. And it says the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, bands of glory. I know Jesus is the Word, but listen, Jesus was God, but he was also man. This Bible that you have in your possession is also God and man. You ever think about that? We don't want man to have no credit in it. Well, I can't help it. Man's got a lot of credit in it. But it was holy men.
Right. Amen.
And they spoke when they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Did you know I have a different personality from Larry and Christy and Harold? We've all got different personalities. You know what I'm saying, right? We got different ways of getting points across. Amen. But still the same God. God takes us just as we are. I told Johnny when he announced his call to preach, I said, Johnny, God called you just like you are, so go be you.
Amen.
Let God use you the way you are.
Right.
If he wouldn't have wanted it, he wouldn't have called you.
Yeah.
You can't be somebody else, be you. Just as Jesus was God and man, God used man to write his word. If not, then why are the 40 of the 66 books named after mankind? Some of you getting knocked off your religious horse this morning.
Amen.
Think about it. You say, is it really 40? you don't believe me, go to the front of your Bible and count them. 40. What's God's number? Hello? I'm glad that just as Jesus was God and man, think about it. He could go up to that woman at the well and be tired and thirsty, Dawn. That's man. But he could give living water. That's God.
Amen.
Just as he could fall asleep in a boat because he was tired. That was man. But he could step up and say, peace be still. That's God.
Amen.
Just as he could go to a funeral where they done buried a man, he could weep at the grave. My Bible says Jesus wept.
Yeah, right.
He was man, but he could also say, remove the stone.
Yeah.
Lazarus, come forth. That's
Amen.
God.
Amen.
And the same way in this book, God took the personalities of these people to record his word the way he wanted it recorded. And he let them write it in their style and in their personality, but yet he guarded it by the Holy Spirit, Larry, and says, I'm going to get my message proclaimed exactly the way I want it proclaimed. And then we got people today that try to challenge God's word. And they try to think they've been moved of God. Hey, let me tell you something. And I'm not knocking everybody, but I'm here to stand for Jesus. Is that okay? I'm here to tell you about the way, the truth, and the life. I'm here to tell you there's no other name under heaven given where man can be saved. Let me tell you something. Joseph Smith didn't uncover a big rock out yonder in Utah and find a new copy of God's word to be added unto it. The Bible says this is it. It has been preserved as the canon. That's called a ruler, if you will, by the early church. This is the end of the word of God. Revelation says, if any man add unto the words of the book of this prophecy, the plagues of this book will be added unto him. If any man taketh away of the words of the prophecy of this book, his part shall be taken away out of the Lamb's book of life. I say unto you, this is a finished product, and what you and I need to do is apply it and make sure we're walking in the light. If we're not applying it, we're stumbling in the darkness. Come on, Lord, I'm done. Come on, let's have the invitation. Let's stand. If you're here and you're lost, you need to be saved. I beg you, come to Jesus today. Christian, I don't know what your situation is. I don't know what you're dealing with. But I can tell you this. All the answers to your problems is not in Preacher Joey. All the answers to your problems is not in Victory Baptist Church. All the answers to your problems is certainly not out in the world. And I got news for you too, this also. All the answers to your problems ain't going to be found in another church house. All the answers to your problem is found in God's precious and holy word. When's the last time you picked it up? When's the last time you studied it? When's the last time you read it? You say, oh, preacher, I read that thing last night before I come to Sunday school. Hallelujah. What'd you do last Monday through Friday? There's people that'll read the newspaper from front to back and never miss an article. And they'll come up and say, preacher, do you see what was in the news? Do you see what was in the news? Do you see what was in the news? No, I don't have to. I done seen it right here.
Amen.
Let's sing. Whatever your need is, it's your invitation. Maybe you're here and you want to join our church. Anyway, we receive our members. If you feel led of God to come and join this fellowship of believers, we open the doors of the church. Be glad to have you. Whatever the need may be, Jesus is your answer. He and he alone is your answer. You can stumble or you can walk. I don't know about you, but I've stumbled a few times. I've stumbled physically. You know what? Stumbling's hard to do. You can stumble around, try to get your balance. Eventually, you know what happens? Fall. But I know what it's like to walk, too. Thank God for the blessing of being able to walk. And not only that, but being able to walk in the light of his love. God knows us. He really does. He knows the hairs of our head, don't he? He knows where we're at with our walk. He knows how we are. We can't fool him. We ain't got inside the gate yet, just like the choir was singing. Everything's going to be all right when we get inside the gate, but we ain't inside it yet. But we need to make sure that we're walking the straight and the narrow way. to the gate. I don't know about you, but this word right here, it ain't been so much preachers, but I've had God's word straighten me out. I've took a few of the knots of God's hard learning, if you will. Many of the knocks, Brother Marty, I didn't have to take. But you know why I took the knocks? Because I wouldn't listen to the still small voice. See, God speaks with a still small voice. And if you won't listen to that, get ready. He can knock hard. I'm going to share this. I'm through. You come Wednesday night. Daniel chapter 4. A lunatic. A psychopath who God had allowed to conquer the modern world at that time. He had a vision of a tree spraying great, filled the whole earth, went up into heaven. It produced fruit. The birds of the air could lodge in it. It was a shade for the animals below. In other words, speaking of Nebuchadnezzar's greatness in his kingdom. He saw that dream. It troubled him again, Samantha, just like the one in chapter 2. This time, he said, I'm not going to call for Daniel. He might tell me the truth. He called them astrologers again. They came in, they still couldn't. They give him some interpretation. He knowed it was a lie. He said, out. He called in Daniel. Daniel says, I wish this dream was concerning your enemies, but it concerns thee. Oh, Nebuchadnezzar. He said, but repent that God might be merciful unto you and he can change this. But if not, it's coming your way. We don't understand things, Tony. We're not like God, Larry. Many times if we send judgment, we send it now. God is merciful. God gave Nebuchadnezzar a full 1 year to repent. Did he? Nope. And here's what got him, because that's what pride does. God hates pride, always has, still does today. Nebuchadnezzar was walking upon the walls of Babylon. This wall was so wide you could probably run 3 to 4 chariots side by side. I mean, we're talking about a modern day fantasy of an empire. And Nebuchadnezzar's walking upon the wall and he says, look at this great Babylon that I have built. And immediately God struck him with insanity. And for 7 years, he was driven outside the gates of that city. He grazed grass like an oxen. His old hair became matted from the dew of heaven. It looked like feathers on a bird. His old fingernails grew like claws on a bird. He was a wild man. He was a mad man. At the end of 7 years, God restored him. He got saved. Hello.
Amen.
But you know what? He took a 7-year hard lesson that never had to come his way. Why? If he'd have done what Daniel told him. Amen. Repent.
Amen.
Repent now. And you won't go crazy. All right, that's a preview of Wednesday. Anybody got a word before we go? Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Bible says he'd supply all our needs according to his riches in glory. His riches in glory don't wear out, so I guess we can take from that that all our needs will be supplied. Not wants, but needs. Anyone else?
No, I'd just like to say I thank God for saving me. You know, I've been so unworthy to him, and yet he's so merciful to me. I just praise God. I wasn't raised up in a Christian home. Wasn't raised up. I struggled to go to church and stuff when I was a kid. Yearned to go, but just couldn't get there. I just thank God that, you know, he grabbed a hold of me one day, and he said, I got something better planned for you. And sometimes I don't know that journey and that path, and sometimes I might slide and I fall, but you know, I just thank God he's so merciful for me that he gets hold of me. He says, hey, I ain't let you. I ain't no forsake you. Get back on track. And he grabbed a hold of me, and he get me right back where I need to be and focused right back on there, you know. And I look around, and I see how blessed I am to have family, children that are in church, you know, and it's a blessing.
Amen.
It's been good to be here this morning.
Amen. Amen. Sure has.
Good.
Sure has.
And I was this morning, my family,
uh-huh,
is here with me. The thought come over my mind, they all say, what a blessing that is to know.
Amen.
Amen. All of my family is saved,
yeah,
except, of course, my little grandchild, which is just over a year old. My prayer is that someday,
yeah,
he'll realize, you know, that he needs Jesus,
amen,
to be saved too. But what a blessing it is to know when that day comes, if whenever or whatever it should be, I know where they're going.
Amen.
I know that. I know a lot of families don't have that blessing.
Yeah.
I've seen that, and I'm just thankful that I can stand here and say that today, because that time's coming when,
yeah,
we all are going to leave this world.
You're right, Tim.
As we sung that song, I'll Fly Away.
Yeah.
One day, whether it's by the rapture or by the grave, it's going to come.
Yeah.
And we're going to fly away. Leave this old world.
We sure are.
And just, you know, I pray for you and your family that someday maybe God will see that you have that blessing as I have when I look at mine.
Amen.
Because it is truly a blessing in knowing that.
I think of that song, What Will I Leave Behind? It's an old one. Boy, we need to be singing some of them old ones again, don't we?
Amen.
What will I leave behind? You think about that a minute. I'm going to hush and go. I saw an obituary this week. Someone had passed away. And that obituary built that person up as the greatest old Christian, most devout, love God, love Christians, sung songs, blah, blah, blah. I know a little about him. To my knowledge, I couldn't tell you when's the last time he was in the house of God. Honey, you can try to build up anybody you want to build up on paper. But God knows whether you're walking in the light,
amen,
or stumbling in the darkness. We can write all the good epitaphs and obituaries we want to write about people. But the bottom line is this. They're not going to be judged out of our book. They're going to be judged out of his books. And his books are right. And they'll have a record of every time they missed, every time they didn't do what they said they're doing. You know what I'm saying? God help us. If our families are saved, thanks be unto God for that. I'm in the same boat with Tim. My family's saved. But you know what? I still pray for lost people. I still keep preaching and telling the old story and get like a fool sometimes, because I want more to go with me to heaven. I'm not satisfied with just my family, Marty. I don't want nobody going to hell, Samantha. I want everybody to go to heaven.
Amen.
And they can go if they'll do it God's way.
Right.
And good to be here.
Amen.
I'm glad we've got a good place to come. I'm glad we can come and feel God's Spirit. All we ain't perfect. If I know making this a perfect church meant me leaving, I'd leave today. But even if I left, I don't think it'd still be perfect. But I'm thanks be unto God, we've got a forgiving church.
Amen.
And we've got a church that loves God. And we strive to be more like him every day. Amen.
Right.
Joy to be here. Joy to be here. Thomas, dismiss us in prayer, please.
Our dear most gracious Heavenly Father God, we just thank you for your love and your kindness and your mercy. Lord, Father God, I thank you for this church, Lord, and how everyone here just comes as one accord to worship you, Father God, just giving you the praise and glory and the uplift, Lord, that you deserve to have, Lord. Lord, my prayer today is that when we leave out these doors, that no one leaves out lost, Father God. And Lord, I just pray that we use your mighty word and your knowledge, Lord, that as we step out through the weekly, Lord, that we'll let our light shine and that other men will see our works and glorify you, giving you all the praise and glory. Lord, just go with us, lead us, guide us, and direct us, and forgive us where we fail you. In Jesus' precious, sweet, holy, saving name, we do pray and ask. Amen.
Remember, the service is Wednesday night. Remember, next Sunday, the Gideon will be here, so be prepared to give a love offering unto the Gideons. God bless you.
Bye.